Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
We are gathered here this morning to celebrate the goodness of the Lord. To show our appreciation and our thankfulness to our God and even to our pastor. It is a good thing for the church to do that. The scripture teaches us that we should give thanks in everything. As according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18, we should give thanks in everything. But you know, we live in a generation where a lot of us are unthankful. I'm sure you are aware that most of the time, wherever we are, there are quite a lot of complainings than being thankful. We have even come to a point where we forget to be thankful. Because there is a lot of complaining around us. We are also complaining. Everybody is complaining. You know, it's like someone said, he heard someone said, there is fear all over. Everybody is afraid. Even God is afraid. So the way we complain, the way we... This generation, how it is complaining. We may even feel like God is also complaining. But now, it's a good thing for us to gather together in this manner and just say, thank you. From the testimonies that you have heard, from the welcome remarks that we have received from Elder Robert.
We are going
to appreciate God and appreciate our pastor. It is in such a time at such a time that we distinguish ourselves from a generation that continuously complains. You know, we complain at work about our employers. Our employers are complaining about us. We complain, you know, in our families, husbands complaining against wives, wives against husbands, parents against children, children against parents. Sometimes even in the church, pastors are complaining about members. Members are complaining about pastors. Followers are complaining about leaders, and leaders are complaining about
followers.
In most cases, there is complaining all over.
But it's
satisfying for us to be able to gather in this manner and say thank you, not only to God. You know, we complain against each other and we stand before God and say thank you. We sometimes complain. Once you finish complaining about something, you turn to God and say thank you. But it's wholesome when we are able to come together, you know, and look at each other and say thank you. Even before we raise our voices to him and to say to him, thank you. It's a commendable thing that we should continue to do. At the same time, we need to remember that to give thanks is a very powerful tool. When we bring it either to those who have done good to us or to God who always does good to us. Okay, before we talk about maybe giving thanks or appreciating those who serve us like we are doing to our pastor
today,
we need to reflect and maybe, you know, get to understand why it's important to be thankful. God created us in such a manner that we have limitations. We can't go all over and be all over and do everything by ourselves. So we are made in such a way that somehow there is something or there is a place where we cannot reach as much as there may be some things that we may be, not be able to do for ourselves. And I think this was the wisest thing that God did. To have us limited. Because that makes it possible for us to recognize and appreciate some external force that are able to come through for us where we are not able to reach. I was thinking, I thought, does God ever say thank you? My reason for thinking through in that manner was, as I have just said, for us human beings, we are limited. And because of our limitation, God made us in such a way that we may be placed in a position of thankfulness. Because we can't do everything for ourselves. We can't be everything in everything. God, who is all things, is able in everything. Limited as though made in his image. So we may be able to raise our heads, our eyes to him and say, thank you. You have been with us. You have taken us this far. You have done this for us. You have done that for us. We are able to be thankful because we recognize we are not self-sufficient. We are dependent on the Almighty and the All-Able God. To reach certain destinies or certain lands and to be able to, you know, to do certain things. Without God's help, we would not be able to do certain things or achieve or reach out to certain things.
Re ne re ka se ke re khone gore re hithelle dilo tse dingwe tse di rileng kgotsa re hithele go gongwe.
But God always comes through for us.
Me modimo kana go tsohle wa re khontsa.
So that where I'm unable to reach.
Gore ha ke sa khone go hithella teng.
Through him he will reach for me.
Ka bo yene ke bele gore ya no ke khona go hithla ko.
That is why we need each other. And it becomes important for us to learn to be thankful all the time, everywhere. Because no matter who you are, no matter where you are, no matter what you have, you are still limited. And somehow you are forced to seek extension from someone. And for that reason, you ought to be thankful to them. Because on your own, you would not have done it. We thank God he made us limited. The other reason that we need to recognize is that God made us limited so that we may be thankful all the time to him. Because had we been self-sufficient, we could not be able to say thank you
to him.
But because we know we are limited, we often have to turn back to him and say thank you for affording us the ability to go this far.
Even
for the simple things like breathing in and breathing out. It's those things that we cannot do by ourselves. God has given us the grace. It is him who made it possible for that to happen. Now,
me,
God is the creator of everything. And everything, as I read from the scriptures, even the beings and the creatures in heaven, give thanks to him. They often turn to him and say, thank you. We give thanks to you for this, for that, for having done that. They are also thankful to God. How much more of us, human beings? So when we gather like this and say thank you to God, this is an extraordinary activity. Because it is not only like it's among ourselves. We are raising our voices to God.
Our voices.
At the same time, we understand that it's not only us who give thanks to God, even the beings in heaven does the same. We also need to recognize that thanksgiving has power in it. When you appreciate and thank someone for having done something for you, you are motivating that person to do it again. Because you recognize that you could not have done it except with his help or his assistance. So you are empowering someone when you say thank you to them. You are making it possible for them to do better, to do more, to continue doing what they are doing. So when you give thanks to someone, you are empowering them.
Now,
because you cannot empower God with your thanksgiving, with your thanksgiving, you are causing God to act on your behalf where you cannot do. When we give thanks to God, unlike us human beings, as we give thanks one to the other, we are empowering and encouraging each other. With God, we are causing Him to rise on our behalf, to stand on our behalf. I read the scripture and I heard one day there was a situation arose in Israel. The enemy of Israel came against him. And King Jehoshaphat noted, this thing is too much for me. He noted that I cannot face this thing alone. There are too many for us. They are too powerful for us. And he turned to God. Sought his face. And God arranged for him to do something that will cause him, God, to manage the situation. And he said to
Jehoshaphat,
gather your people. Gather your forces. Rise up, go towards the battlefield. Before you go, ensure that those who are able to praise, those who are able to sing, those who are able to raise voices of praise and thanksgiving to me, walk in front of your armies. And God did something extraordinary in that day. Something that with the human eye you would not understand. Jehoshaphat did as the Lord asked him to do. And just as they were marching towards the armies that were against them, and they were singing those songs of praise, and they were shouting out to God, we have heard and we know that the Lord came through and faced their enemies and fought for them and overcame their enemies for them. They did not at the end of the day had to fight, because praise us. People who were able to raise voices to God, bring voices of thanksgiving to God, were marching ahead and doing the same. God had to act. I said the other day, in that situation, something interesting was going on. Because as we know, I think for those of us who have been Christians for maybe 10 years or more, we are aware of this statement that as we sing, we are preparing ourselves for heaven. Because in heaven we are singing and praising. You know that. We used to say that we should do that because we are preparing ourselves. Now, this is what I want to say. When They sang. Those who were leading the armies of Jehoshaphat, they were doing what is familiar in heaven. Now, I want you to see this. What do you think is going to happen? If heaven hears voices from earth of praise and of thanksgiving, and when they hear these voices, they note that such voices as these are as those who are with us here. What do you think will happen? In a moment, something should happen. Because for them though that are in heaven, they are noting that what is happening on earth is the same as what is happening here. It seems we are the same. Heaven has gone down to earth as has come down to heaven. And that is why it became easy for God to deal with the armies that were against Israel. Because it was in that situation that those angels which were in heaven and were hearing the voices on earth would have, if you will, said, we are going down there to join them. Only to realize that they are in the battle front. If at all, when they heard the voices, they didn't recognize. I'm just making assumptions here. Understand. When they got there, they realized they are in battle. And they said, this can't be. This cannot be. And they came forth. And they faced the battle of the voice of the battle of those who were against the voices that they had come to join. You can't say thank you. Genuinely thank you. And give praise to God. And it remains as if you have done nothing. It cannot remain the same. That is why the scripture encourages us to give thanksgiving in everything. Because the power of thanksgiving is beyond what we can imagine. When you appreciate this gentleman and lady, you are even causing them to go beyond what they could by themselves. You are empowering them. You are encouraging them. You are pushing them forward. You are saying, go on, we are with you. They will not be afraid to take steps further than where they are. Because they know they are not alone. And in that way, we are distinguishing ourselves from a generation that continues to complain, even in church. When you are a pastor, and you are complaining against the members, and the members are complaining against you, you want to distance yourself because you are not sure whether you are safe or not. You want to move a little bit further. Deal with them from there. Because you are not sure if you are safe. But when you are appreciated, when they show you appreciation and they thank you, they're making you one of them. They're making you to be there. They make it possible for your for his doors to be open. Because he also knows that your hearts are open. And brothers and sisters, this morning, I want us to recognize that what we are doing is a powerful thing. And please, let us not take this as traditional. When it becomes traditional, there will come a time where we start to complain about it. We will be doing it, but complaining at the same time that we are doing it. You know that situation where something starts off good, when we start off something with hearts that are willing, we miss the focus in the journey. When we miss the focus, we continue doing this but complaining about it. When that happens, the grace, the favor, the goodness that the Lord would bestow upon you will be upheld. It cannot continue to be flowing as it used to be. And I implore you this morning, every time you go through this session, every time you do this, open your heart. And do this with all your heart. When you pray, or you come to God and say to God, thank you for this, thank you for that. And just as you finish, when you walk out, you start saying, I've been praying for too long. God is not even saying anything. I've not heard God saying anything for the past 3 months. I've not received anything for the past year from God. You have just come before God, and immediately you are complaining against it. What do you expect? Do you expect to receive anything? Ladies and gentlemen, our hearts need to be open. Our heart needs to be free. We need to ensure that during such times as these of thanksgiving, our hearts are open. We are willing participants in what we are doing. If you look at Psalms 136, it says, are we there? Psalms 136. Hallelujah this morning.
Amen.
Psalms 136 says,
Yari.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
Nela Jehovah malebo gonne o molemo.
For his mercy endures forever.
Kama ukolo botlhokwa gagwe a eme ka bosakhutleng.
Oh, give thanks to the God of gods.
Leboga modimo wa medimo.
For his mercy endures forever.
Oh,
give thanks to the Lord of lords. For his mercy endures forever. Now, the psalmist in this text is just saying, give thanks to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord. And he gives us reasons why we should be thankful to the Lord. I'm sure. Even among us, there is, you know, you cannot just say thank you to the air for nothing. You cannot just say thank you. There must be something that is attached to your thank you. You're not just saying thank you. Now the psalmist says, give thanks to the Lord. Why? For he is good. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. And because his mercies endure forever. Now, when we give thanks to the Lord, we have the reason why we give thanks to him. We have heard testimonies here. And we should be able to stand before the Lord and say, thank you. Because you have seen and heard what you have done. We have a tangible reason why we thank you. But even more, we thank him because he is good. And his mercies endures forever. When his mercies does not change, as the scripture says, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. When we understand and recognize that his mercies endures forever, we can now and then, oftentimes, turn back to him and say thank you. Because his mercies keeps picking us. Every day, his mercies keep picking us. Every day, his mercies keep shielding us. Every day, his mercies keep watching over us. Every day, his mercies keep providing for us. Every day, his mercies keep healing us. Every day, his mercies keep giving us peace. Every day, his mercies come through for us. His mercies may have come through in a different way to me than to you, but it has come through. His mercies endures forever. So we cannot outlive the mercies of God. And because we cannot outlive it, we have to be thankful all the time to him. We have to be thankful for his mercies that are enduring. And even then, that he is God of gods. He is Lord of lords. And as you read from verse 4 downwards, the psalmist mentions a lot of things that causes him to say, give thanks to the Lord. And brothers and sisters, this morning, as we gather together, as we stand here to give thanks to the Lord, let us do it with our hearts bubbling with joy. Let us do that with gladness. Let leave complaining somewhere. Leave it behind somewhere. Embrace thankfulness. You know, things that causes complaining will never stop. Will never come to an end. But what good will we be if we join the world, those who do not know Christ, those who do not know the need for being thankfulness and continue complaining with them. What good will it be to us? We will not benefit anything. So we rather choose a path that will benefit us. Be different. You know, it's not that we deserve the things that are done for us or to us. You know, lately, because we think we have rise and therefore we deserve a lot of things. Yep. Even when good is done to us, we just look at it as if it was my right. Just as, you know, you'd sit here and say, I have the right for this pastor to have done this to me. So why should I thank him? Why should I appreciate him? Because I have the right for him to serve me in the way
he's serving me.
When you do that, brothers and sisters, you should know the same source that causes someone to be blessed because of thankfulness will dry over your life. Let me tell you something. It is important to know that our attitude towards what we do determines the fruitfulness of the saying. We may be doing the same thing, but our approach and attitude to it determines whether it becomes fruitful or it doesn't become fruitful to us. So don't complain. Rather, step back and make assessment of your heart. Because it is when you do that you will be able to realize where you have closed. Be a willing participant. Be a willing participant. If you do that, you are ensuring that you benefit as you are supposed to. The psalmist says, give thanks to the Lord. You also see it in chapter
107.
He says the same thing, give thanks to the Lord for he is good. You know, David is one of those men we should learn some few lessons that are very important from. One day, he calls his people. And he said to them, you know, I want to build a house for the Lord. I have what I have to contribute. And may we all do the same. And they did that. after they have outdone his expectation, he went to the Lord and he said to him, who am I? And who are my people who are able to do this? Because none of the things that we have done are ours, they are yours. What we have brought forth for the building of the temple has always been yours, and it is yours. David was an amazing man. He learned to be thankful all the time. He never came to a point where he had thought he has done it himself. Brothers and sisters, every one of us ought to be thankful at some stage. But even then, every time you ought to be thankful. For a church to organize and arrange such a day as this one is just to remind us that we ought to be thankful. That we need to continuously be thankful. Now, as we continue, I want us to look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 12. Some sister quoted it earlier. But I want us to share a few thoughts from that verse. First Thessalonians. Chapter 5, verse 12. And we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you. And to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Be at peace among yourselves. Let us take about 5 minutes or so and look at this text. Verse 13 says, and esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. For what? For their work's sake. Now, I want us, as we look at this text, to understand one or two things. Paul encourages the brethren to esteem those who are working amongst them doing the Lord's work highly. For the sake of the work they are doing. Why really for the sake of the work that they are doing? Why really for the sake of the work that they are doing? Why is Paul coming from there? I'm as human as you are. My brother is as human as you are. Right? We are as human. As you are. We eat bread, we drink 5 roses. And you know, we do that just as you do. What different are we from you? Now, Paul wants us to see something very important here. He is saying for their work's sake. Why for their work's sake? Okay, Mr. Leseho. I know. We do have people who sometimes are even more gifted than we are.
Re itse ha gona le bangwe ba ka tswang ba neilwe go heta le rona.
So what is Paul saying?
Tota se Paulo a se buang keng?
If we do have people who are sometimes, and in many cases, more gifted than we are, sometimes we are not even as eloquent as most of you are.
Mo e leng gore nako e nngwe o fitlhela le gore re na le batho ba e leng gore ba hilwe go heta jaaka ga rona, mme ebile gongwe ile ba kgona go bua le go heta jaaka ga re ka bua rona.
But Paul is saying,
me Paulo are,
esteem them highly,
ba tlotlele go heta,
in love for their work's sake,
ka lerato ka ntata tiro e ba e dirang.
God is very interesting, very interesting.
Modimo wa hakhamatsa.
He's very interesting.
Wa hakhamatsa thata.
But he goes to the house of the father of David, I've just forgotten his name.
Jesse.
He goes to Jesse's house. Through
Samuel.
Stands at the door of Jesse's house. And says to Jesse, I have come to your house to anoint King of Israel, and I am not going to sit down until I have done that.
Ke tle go ntlunya ga go gotla go tlotsa khosi ya Israel, mme ga kena ke nna ha batse go ikhellela ke dira tiro eo.
Bring me your children.
Le re bana ba gago.
And Jesse thought, my firstborn.
Jesse aba akanya morwake wa ntla.
Who else but him?
Ye ka nna mang ha se ene wa.
Giant, strong.
And
Samuel says,
Samuel,
I have not come for this one. Bring another one. And he kept bringing them. Samuel says, it's not this one. Until those who were home were all finished. And Samuel said, old man, are these all? Because I'm sent here. Among these, I have no one. Are these all? Jesus says, yes, except that there is a little boy looking after the sheep.
Jesse
knows
that he's
somewhere.
He's somewhere.
It's looking after sheep. And Samuel said, I told you I'm not sitting down until I anoint king over Israel. Go get that boy for me. Because during the process, Samuel got tempted.
Samuel
to anoint one of them, God said no. You see you. You look at the outside. I don't do the same. I look in the inside. So I saw all this. None of this has the heart I am looking for. Go and get that one. Let me check if the heart is there. Jesse had to arrange quickly.
Jesse
had the boy to come. I don't know whether he watched or whatever, but he had to come. Just as he walked through, the Lord said to Samuel, that's the one. Rise up and anoint him. As human as you are, sometimes we may not see what God sees. And because we do not see what God sees, we judge according to what we see. Now, David would not have become a king according to Jesse.
Tafite ne ka ske ne khosi hanne le gore Jesse ke ena a laolang.
But according to God,
me go ya ka modimo,
he was the one.
Tafite ene ene.
He was supposed to be the king.
Ke na a tshwanwa ka gore ene khosi.
And indeed he became the king.
Me khontse jalo ana khosi.
And you know what?
Me ra itse gore
God anointed him.
Modimo a motlotsa.
And by anointing him,
me ka go motlotsa,
he made him different.
A modira pharologanye.
For the work that he was assigning him to do. You are only made different as my brother has been by the assignment you have been given. That's what distinguishes you from others. Now when God does that, unfortunately, consultation becomes thin. When he does that, he doesn't consult. He makes a decision by the determination of the heart. When I met him in 94, I never thought he could become a pastor. Never thought. I'm surprised he's a good pastor. But you know, we thank God. Because in that gentleman that I saw then, there was a heart that God was seeing. That I never saw with my eyes. So, for this sake, that God chooses as he wishes, even as he understands the vessel. We should be able, for that sake of God's decision and choice, to esteem them highly. Not because as we look at them, they look like
Batshwana.
Not because of that, but because God has made a decision. Now, the other thing that we need to know,
we have
heard testimonies, right? These are not the only testimonies that you have heard, I know. You have heard many. You also have heard yours. That you have given at some time or you are about to give. Because of what God has done through his servant who he has placed among you. Let me tell you the last thing. The scripture says, when it talked about Abraham and Melchizedek, when you jump it to Hebrews, it says, the greater, it says, the lesser is blessed by the greater. It says, the lesser is blessed by the greater. Let me show you something that is very important for you and for all of us. I'll keep giving him as an example. By him being given the assignment he has been given over this assembly or over the body of Christ, he has been given the authority over it. I want you to hear me clearly. I want you to hear me very clearly. Mrut, I read through Genesis.
Genesis.
My observation has been no child blesses the parent.
Yo o tshego hatsa motsadi wa gagwe.
And this is what I mean.
Me ke se ke se le mogang.
When you look through Genesis.
How le bella le kwalo la Genesis.
It was fathers.
Ine le borre.
Who released blessing over their children.
Ba bana ba tshego hatsa bana ba bona.
Never had has it happened that it happens. Otherwise. Because it is the greater, the lesser who is blessed by the greater.
We live
in a generation where everybody blesses everybody. Even in the church, we are not afraid. To lay your hands upon your pastor. Which authority is that one? Where did you get it? That's a disorder. I don't know if it is the right word, but you hear what I'm trying to say.
Now,
in this church generation, everybody is blessing the other. Some young person just comes here and you see running and he lays his hands upon Relisego as an elder in the church. I bless you. What has happened to us? We have lost it. Your pastor has the authority to do that over any one of you because of the assignment that he has been given. He has the authority to do that. In this case, it's not an issue of age. It's an issue of assignment. Now, what am I trying to say? I said earlier, the lesser is blessed by the greater. When he closes his heart to you, go and look for someone else to bless you. Because if his heart towards you is not open, you cannot receive the grace and the blessing that is bestowed on him. It's only possible when his heart is open towards you. The father of Jacob and Esau said to Esau, I'm already about to die, but make me happy so I can bless you. That is why he said, go and find game meat for me. Prepare something nice, something good. Jacob himself, when he blessed his children, you know, it was at Judah, who was not the firstborn. That he pronounced authority over him to be king. over Israel.
Ke ene a ileng a motsego hatsa gore e ya go nna ene khosi mo godimo ga Israel.
Until
go hikelela
Jesus Christ comes.
Jesu Kriste.
Because of this one thing.
Kantatase.
The elder brothers.
Ba ba mogoluwe.
Had caused the father head.
Ba ne ba ira ba ukwisitse rabo botlhoko.
So he couldn't.
Ona ka seka khone.
Go and read chapter 41-42.
Genesis.
When he was blessing his children. Read what he says to the first two. Because he was not happy. I know. You stand here to say to me. I have. I am also as anointed.
Le nna ke tloditswe hela jaaka ene.
I have also received the Spirit.
Le nna ke amogetse mowa.
But Paul is saying,
Me Paulo a re,
esteem them highly.
Ba tloteng
thata. Those who labor among you.
Ba ba lo direlang.
And who are over you in the Lord.
Ba ba lo okametse mo moreneng.
You cannot be sheep without a shepherd and prosper.
Galoka ke la nna dingkutse di sina modisa melatlega.
You cannot be sheep without a shepherd and all things go well.
Galoka ke la nna dingkutse di sina modisa melaga tsengwe le se sa tsamaya sentle.
Try it.
Leka.
Guys or lena le dingku le dipudi le.
I know you have goats and sheep.
Try it.
Leka.
Di tlogale di sna modisa.
Just leave them without a shepherd.
Just leave them o bona gore go tla iragala.
O bone hele see what is going to happen.
And learn a story and a lesson from that.
O bo ka ithuta go tswa ho.
Brothers and sisters.
Ba ka olengwe.
This morning I wanted to say to you.
Mo bo songwa gompieno ke batle gore ke le re kere.
All the time. It's right for us to give thanks to God. But we also have, because of our limitation, to be thankful first to God and thankful to one another. And in such a setup, be thankful to our pastor who is saving us with all his
heart.
It's not me who said that, it's you who said that.
He's
saving you and saving you well. I pray that the Lord will bless you, that he will be gracious to you, that through him he will continue to extend you, to enlarge you, and to bestow his favor upon you. May everything go well with you. And may the hand of the Lord be upon you. As you continue to open your hearts and work together with the servant of God. God bless you. Thank you for putting me this opportunity.
Hallelujah.